Today we assemble and paint the once great watchtower of Amon Sul, or better known to most of us as Weathertop. This beautiful resin scenery kit is by Games Workshop and it is huge and fairly heavy, so you'll need some strong wrists for this one. This is going to be the largest resin kit that I've certainly worked with, so let's see what you get. Some nice thick chunks of resin with some pretty nice details. A quick guide to building resin model kits, which includes the tools that you'll need for the job and how to prep the resin. And importantly, this product was checked by Pat. Thanks, Pat. With the kit being so large, it actually wasn't that complex, with it being 16 pieces in total. However, I did notice that the numbers on the components are completely wrong. For example, like this number 6 archway section being number 2. And for a kit that's north of £300, this piece of paper designer should know better. These resin miniatures are made by pouring material into a mold, so we need to cut off the excess resin before we can begin assembly. A hobby razor saw was the tool of choice here, because the blade is sharp, thin and sturdy, but the teeth are also very small, giving you a nice fine cut. It's also worth mentioning a health and safety tip here. If you are going to saw resin, you do not want resin dust floating around and going into your lungs. Here I'm using my airbrush mask, but I'm also cutting on a damp dishcloth, so all the excess sawn off resin is contained. If you don't have a razor saw, then you can use some clippers. However, do not use the Citadel ones, because they are far too flimsy for this material. But you should be able to find a decent enough pair in your local hardware store. A quick note when using clippers is to make sure you hold on to that resin, otherwise you'll take someone's eye out as it pings away. My normal method is to clasp onto the whole piece of resin and then cut safely in the middle. Once you have gone through all of the pieces, you will have a whole bunch of excess resin which you could use for scenery, paperweights, Christmas decorations, anything you want. This is a crafty channel. The next thing we need to do is tidy up the areas that we have just cut, and for this I'm using my scalpel knife. Now these knives are pretty sharp, so just be careful. And I'm sure there are people watching this going, "Never cut towards yourself!" But for me, I have a lot more control doing it this way than hacking at something and pushing the blade away from me, wailing my sharp knife into the air. The main thing is to just take it slowly and be safe for you, as we don't want any trips to A&E explaining why we've been stabbed by a Morgul blade at Weathertop. Sometimes a knife is just not going to cut it, and you might want to create a smoother finish that little bit quicker. So we're using this super fine sandpaper that's been drenched in water. Again, we don't want that resin dust going everywhere. You also want to give kits like this the quick once over, just to make sure there aren't any excess resin bits like this window. Often it's fairly thin like paper, and you can clean up the surrounding area by whittling away the resin with a scalpel knife. On other occasions, you might find resin which just didn't quite cure, or it may have leaked out of the mold. This wibbly wobbly substance can be taken off with a scalpel knife fairly easily. On some resin kits, you might find that they're slightly greasy to touch or a bit shiny, and that's down to the release agent used to get them out of the molds. And paint won't stick to this too well, so we're gonna give them a quick bath with some warm water and some soap detergent. And give them a little scrub with a toothbrush, which is not your own. Don't make that mistake. Set it down on the tea towel to dry for a little bit before we begin assembly, and don't forget to clean your sandpaper that you used earlier. Ready for your next project. As this is a resin kit, plastic glue has no power here, and it will not work. so we need to use some superglue instead. I prefer rather using the gel variety over the liquid, as I can add blobs here and there, knowing it can pretty much stay in place without it running onto my finger, thus avoiding gluing myself onto the scenery. And if you would like to speed things along like I do, then using a super glue activator like this will make the glue dry instantly. I'll leave links to all the products that I use in the video today in the description below, just in case you might need to pick anything up for your future scenery projects. And the question of the day is, what scenery project are you guys going to be working on next? As a quick note, this rubble is separate, so you can have it removable when you play your game. So you might not want to glue this into position. The scenery is fully assembled now, but gee willikers, there are some big gaps here and there. Now, you could decide to leave some of these because it's a ruined piece of scenery, or you can fill the gaps with something like Milliput. The way this epoxy putty works is by mixing two equal parts of both of the putties together, and then poking the putty into the cracks to fill the gaps. It's quite malleable for a fair few minutes, so you can tease it into position, and then it'll take around about 3 to 4 hours to dry rock hard. Here I just used an old stiff dry brush to create a rocky texture, and then a file just to score some lines into the putty to continue the stonework. Once you are at a stage where you're happy with your gap filling, then we are ready to undercoat the scenery. And for that, we're going to be using some matte black by Colourforge. Hey guys, I'm going to interrupt this main video by sharing with you one crucial, important scenery tip. And that is, when you start spraying, make sure you've got enough spray and you don't run out. Oh damn. So after coming back from the shop and spraying the rest of it black, I then used Trench Brown as our primary base coat colour for our ruined tower. Now I've only used Colourforge for probably just under a year now, after I came across them at the UK Games Expo here in Birmingham, England. And they have a nice variety of colours to choose from, so overall, the ones that I've used so far, I'm pretty impressed with. I didn't cover the black 100% at this stage because we're keeping some of those shaded areas before we paint. As the clouds begin to look gloomy up above and the rain just started to trickle down, ossified earth was then used to spray on the lighter layered colours. But this time I'm hitting the scenery more from an angle, so that it'll leave some of that trench brown in the shadows and crevices to maintain some of those darker tones. I came back to the project the next day after the spray dried, and I also used this revolving dance floor for miniatures to place the tower on. And it just fit my spray booth. Now, the method that I used on this scenery was to first do the undercoat, and then a lighter layer with the spray cans, before moving on to the lightest layer with the airbrush. If you don't have an airbrush, then using makeup brushes will give you a similar result, albeit a little bit slower. Just pick out an appropriate off-white colour to use. And I'll be doing just that very method with some Gondorian scenery later on a future video. So if there's anything that you would like me to cover sooner rather than later for you, then let me know. With our lighter tones finished, we are ready to jump onto the shading. For that, I started off with a Magnolia Brown. It's quite a nice, lightish brown colour, and it'll be great to start our shading. I'm picking out the recesses here, and the gaps in between the stonework itself. This is going to start defining the shape of the sculpt, as we now start to expand the amount from the light to the dark areas. And even with the airbrush, this does take a little while to do, so just be patient and just keep adding the shadows appropriately. At this stage, I also wanted to darken the sandy, rocky areas on the outside of the tower, and this was done with the same Magnolia paint. I also cheated a little bit here with the statues by applying the shade colour, but then using my finger just to rub off the top surface, leaving some highlights intact. And with one round of shaving, it's starting to get there and take shape. We've got some lighter tones and darker tones to the stonework, so let's begin adding some colour. A couple of greys were used to pick out the rocks on the outside. First off with regiment grey being the initial base coat, followed up by dark ghost grey by Vallejo. Whatever colours you end up using, just make sure that you jot them down, in case you extend the scenery later on down the line by placing it on top of a hill. I'm now going to enhance the shading a little bit more and add some brown tones in there. Satchel Brown Speed Paint mixed with a little bit of Tamiya Thinner, about a 50-50 mix, will dilute this down slightly. As this mix is fairly translucent, you can decide how much shading you would like to do by adding more and more layers. At first, I concentrated my efforts mainly on where the stone walls meet, as well as all of the sandy rocky texture that comes up to the stonework. I even added this colour in between the steps, and especially on the sandy texture on the inside, just to make these areas stand out a little bit more. And it will give it a little bit more visual interest when playing games on it. Especially when those boisterous Nazgul come to town on their night out. Now you can just dry brush the edges up with a little bit of white from here, but I'm gonna add a little bit more colour. When you look at ruins a little bit more closely, there is a whole host of colour to the stone. Either through weathering, scorch marks from battle, or just nature slowly taking it back over. You can imagine just little mossy deposits starting to develop here and there in the cracks in the stone. Also, a little splattering tip here is to toggle the trigger back and forth very quickly rather than pressing it down in short bursts. That way you get a randomized spluttering pattern, just like what we have on the stone. And this would work really well for a blood splatter effect too. I gave the rocky stone on the outside of the tower a little bit of shade here with some Hive Dweller Purple. Again, just for those subtle shaded tones, so it doesn't look so flat. And lo and behold, I liked it so much that I also did it for the tower itself. And with the hints of purple going on the stonework, it just gives it that eerie kind of feel to it, which sits well with me because of the scenes in the films, with Frodo and the Nazgul, and Azog and his merry bunch of orcs. And finally, at this stage, I just wanted the sandy areas to be that little bit darker, ready for some dry brushing in a moment. So again, using some good old speed paint and a little bit of thinner, the dark wood was then sprayed onto the majority of this texture. I can't emphasize enough exactly how much I like these paints. Yes, they're really good when you're using them with a brush, but with the added bonus through the airbrush as well, it's a nice 2-for-1 paint pot. And this was a perfect colour just to darken down some of those very dark shadows that I wanted to appear in the corners of the stonework. With the colours of the tower complete, we're just going to go through a couple methods and techniques to bring the scenery to life. First off, we're going to pick out the foliage with a couple of greens. You can either spray them on or use them by brush, it doesn't really matter. We're just going to create a spot colour here, which should give us a bit of extra visual interest on the scenery. And a little bit of poisonous cloud, really cool name by the way, was used to pick out the highlights of this shrubbery texture with a dry brush technique. And for those that are newer to the hobby and want to know a little bit more about dry brushing, it's about taking the majority of the paint out of the bristles from the brush and onto some sort of material, like this sponge here. And this will allow you to pick out the edges of a texture fairly quickly by dry brushing the paint onto the miniature. Some good brushes to use for this method are these larger dry brushes that are fairly flat, and makeup brushes. The thing with dry brushing, especially for scenery, is that it can be quite wasteful in terms of paint, because you're effectively taking off the paint onto a material that you're using before you even start brushing it onto the scenery. So I'll show you a little money-saving tip in a moment after we have dry-brushed this ground texture. Here I've just used a brown and then now a grey to pick out this sandy texture on the kit, as well as some of the debris from the ruined tower itself. I'm gradually building up the colour here, and dry brushing is the method for this. You could try a couple different colours to see what you come up with, or you could tie it in with the rest of your scenery collection or your tabletop. So we have picked out the stonework and foliage, and next up we're just going to finish off the stonework itself. And here is my money-saving tip. Instead of using the more expensive miniature paint on your scenery, pop down to your local hardware store and find an inexpensive tester pot which is pretty much the same colour. You get a lot more paint in there for pretty much half the price. And it doesn't matter if you're a little bit wasteful whilst you're dry brushing. Here I'm just quickly picking out some of the edges of the stonework itself and the rubble. And this is where the dry brushing technique really comes to its own, transforming the scenery before your very eyes by picking out all of the highlights, in a relatively quick fashion. I then switched over to a slightly smaller brush just to pick out some of the more finicky bits on the sculpt. And of course, whilst you're working on the larger scenery kit, don't forget about that smaller piece of rubble that we mentioned earlier. I wanted to push some of those highlights that little bit more, and this will just increase the definition of the ruins. And for that, I picked a lighter colour tester pot, just for this very method. However, this time I used a sponge rather than a dry brush, mainly because this is such a bright colour, and if I went down the dry brush method, it would make the extreme highlights just too bright. And if I were to do some photos with some miniatures, the scenery would just look too sharp in the background, which will draw the eye away from all that hard work that you've done on the miniatures. The terrain in this case is meant to complement what's going on with the scene, rather than taking over the whole thing. Overall, it's a fantastic kit to paint, and would be a mighty addition to anyone's Middle-earth collection. So much so that I painted it twice for commissions in 1 week for 2 different people. And now I want one for myself.